In 1989, Chun Chanye's novel Quiet Mountains was published in Chinese to wild acclaim. It was yet another triumph for a writer, translator, and editor who had devoted a lifetime to promoting exchange between Chinese writers and their counterparts overseas. His was a long and fruitful career. But what is his legacy? Stay tuned to the fourth and final episode of The Writer Who Reached Out to the World.
In 1988, Chun Chanye's trilogy Quieter Than Mountains was published in the UK by Faber & Faber. The Chinese version was published by Yellow River Art Press the following year. In 1989, Chun Chanye invited a delegation of British scholars to China. He himself regularly travelled abroad on visits or to give lectures in Europe and the US. Through him, the world learnt about the new era of burgeoning Chinese literature. He was also able to strengthen his personal contacts with foreign writers.
They talk about Chinese children's literature, some bit of it, and something about my own work in the field of literary writing in China. We have a long oral tradition of children's literature, that is stories, fairy tales, coined spontaneously by mothers, grandmothers, to tell to their children privately.
他被美国、英国、法国 澳大利亚、新西兰这些，一流的大学请去做报告，介绍中国文学和他自己创作的经验和理会，比如说美国的哈佛大学、哥伦比亚大学、伦敦的剑桥大学、澳大利亚的悉尼大学，这些都请他去做个报告。
In 1993, Chun Chanye was taken into hospital. His illness prompted his office to approve his retirement. Now, almost 80, after many years of doing foreign propaganda work, Chun Chanye finally became a full-time writer. Despite his great age and poor health, he embarked on a new career.
晚年的时候，每年还贡献二三四万字的作品，不以自己的病为意，这也是顽强的一种精神。他不像是患了绝症的人，又给我们讲起他自己的创作理会翻译的感受，哎呀，使我很感动。
In his small courtyard home beside Shuchihai Lake, Chun Chanye became increasingly busy. He published a collection of more than 70 essays under the title The Little Birds on the Tree. He also wrote a full-length Chinese novel, Bai Xia, which was his first attempt to write about Chinese women. He published interviews with Chun Chanye, a collection of his speeches, based on many decades of writing and translating adult and children's literature. In total, these books comprised nearly 2 million Chinese characters. In 1997, a forum was held in the conference hall of the Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference, marking 65 years of Chun Chanye's writing career. Liu Yandong, Deputy Minister of the CPC United Front Work Department, gave the congratulatory address.
叶老呢可以说是我们当代啊中国当代啊伟大的一个翻译家和文学家，同时呢叶老呢作为我们中国民主同盟的老前辈，就中国共产党真诚的朋友，叶老用他自己的啊这样的这种行动啊，也团结了和就更多的这个知识分子，为建设我们现代化的国家、社会与现代化的国家啊做出努力，是吧？所以这方面确实也是非常令人敬佩的。
当天的晚上的新闻，中央电视台给予了报道。
CHUN CHANYE says that throughout his life he's walked a tightrope amid the swirl of intense political struggles in China and abroad. It was a matter of survival so that he could make the contribution to humanity that he was able to and that he thought was his obligation. By this he was referring to literary creation and cross-cultural exchange aimed at strengthening international understanding.
周然说呢，我根据你的特长，我给你分到对外文委当处长，也是像你在三厅干的工作一样，就是对接待国际文化友人、送往迎来这些事儿。他做这事是很有经验了，但是呢，这不是他的爱好。
The road chosen by CHUN CHANYE was a literary one, writing in foreign languages and doing translations.He used foreign languages as a tool for enabling foreign readers to understand the life, the struggle, and the fate of the Chinese people.
他从事的工作呢，还是在文化方面，文化方面还是属于人性方面，人性方面。你这个安徒生的童话是讲人性的了，所以他的兴趣嘛，主要在文化、文艺方面，翻译中国的好东西。介绍外国的好东西，
他的创作目的和创作思想，就是他为什么从事文学和翻译，创作和翻译工作，他是为了人民，为了民族，为了受压迫、受剥削的苦难的中国人，他要反映他们的真实生活，向世界人民宣传。
CHUN CHANYE was one of China's leading translators of his generation, a man who was proficient in many languages, English, Esperanto, Spanish, French, German, Danish, Japanese, Portuguese, Norwegian and Swedish among them. For many years he served as deputy chairman of the China Translators Association. He was a member of the executive committee of the World Esperanto Association,and the only Chinese writer to be published in Esperanto. He was also a cultural ambassador for China. In the course of his activities overseas, he developed friendships with the American writer Arthur Miller, the Australian Nobel Literature Prize winner Patrick White, the famous Indian writer Anade,Julian Bell's family, Agnes Smedley, the New Zealander Rewi Ali, and many others.
Now, 现在好多书关于这个 Bloomsbury Group 出版了，特别是在美国哈，关于那个英国的那个文学界哈 ，Bloomsbury 很感兴趣哈，每年开一个大会啊。主要的还是在英国，可是在美国也开了，每年开一个大会啊。叶君健也是一个很有名的、很突出的一个文化桥梁。
Roger Andersen, elsket rejse, men fik
han 中国旅行，但他却没有到过中国。然而中国曾经给他以灵感，激励他撰写了许多童话。他描写中国可能是想象中的中国，但他是中国与我们缩短的距离。叶教授，您以同样的方式，会向贵国介绍丹麦做出了巨大的努力。然而，两个人之间仅在想象力和幽默方面具有相同和共同点是不够的，还需要有人为之铺路搭桥。对您的贡献，无论如何评价都不过分。我今天是带着真诚的喜悦，代表丹麦政府向您南方长夫人表示欢迎。
Han Su-yin writes in English, and her work has been widely read in Europe, the US, and Southeast Asia. At a young age, she studied in the UK and spent most of her life abroad. With Chun Chanye's help, she often returned to visit China, the country of her birth. She was even received by Premier Zhou Enlai. One day during the Cultural Revolution, she turned up unannounced at Chun Chanye's home. She'd been asked by Jiang Qing to write her biography, and she wanted Chun Chanye's advice.
叶老师说我不能告诉你这个事情怎么办，你给他写还是不写，由你自己决定。不过我告诉你，一个作家要写什么东西是由他自己来决定，不能叫别人决定。别人叫你怎么写你就怎么写。那么韩树英听了这个话就说：“那好，我不给他写，是他给我决定我写他，我应该我自己。” 决定写谁就写谁，这个江青看完了，托了韩树英以后，韩树英走了，后来他就找别人，那个人叫维特克，那么维特克回去以后就跟韩树英出书那个书店是一个书店，所以韩树英呢就回去了，那么叶君健就告诉他，你把这个事情啊，你去告诉黄华。 黄华是驻美国大使，黄华是我129的同学，那么他就去告诉黄华了，说是这个中国要出一个本书，是，你中国要出女王，那么黄华就把这事情告诉周总理，周总理就说这个版权要买回来，不能出。
Foreign friends and the foreign media often asked Chun Chanye about the Cultural Revolution. An article in the Times about him read, despite some of his ups and downs, he betrays no bitterness when describing the struggle meetings. Instead, he retains a sense of humour. He smiles a lot and doesn't conceal his continued loyalty to the socialist faith of his youth.
安南是伦敦大学校长，也是他剑桥同学，还有两个也是他剑桥同学，都对他好，甚至于我们没有钱，那么他们就，那时候我们去，除了那个宝龙洋行出钱，他给我们点零花钱，有时候他们也给我们10磅、20磅的钱，叫我们买点东西什么的，你可以在国外。 度过很好的晚年，你到大学里当东方语系的系主任，是大概是斯德哥尔摩大学，然后他说，你的夫人可以在那教中文。后来我就说，我说你有什么想法？他说，我告诉你，咱俩的根是中国，多少钱都不能在外国，所以我觉得他爱国，这一点我们合得来。他们那一代啊。
就是说，大多数这些知识分子还真的是爱国的。我们家倒是老来外国人，啊，当然那时候都是替官方接待的，就是了。他一向他就是从从容容的，好的就是好，不好就是不好的啊。当然那是文化大革命以后了，那之前，人家外国人来，咱们自己也承认了一些错误，他跟外国人也说，我们也犯过错，有什么错？ 啊，这个人，啊，这么大个国家，啊，一个人一辈子，他都难免犯错，犯错你只要承认吧，啊，这下决心改嘛，还是有希望的。孔夫子不是说，知耻近乎勇啊，过也人皆见之，耕也人皆养之。你说我们是犯了错了，是不是？你们也都看见了，我们也承认。
Chun Chanye led a simple life. He neither smoked nor drank alcohol. The only thing he drank was ordinary tea given to him by the people of his hometown. His sole hobby was writing. The suits and shoes he wore when he went abroad were the same ones he'd worn when he was in Western Europe in the 1940s. He got his hair cut by a retired barber in the open air beside Shichihai Lake paying him 2 yuan.
他从丹麦回来以后，他剩了大概3万克朗的钱。到了北京以后，他就交给宝龙洋行的驻京办事处了，说我还给你。他们说感到很惊奇，我们从来没经历这个事儿。这个钱是给你零花的，你爱怎么花怎么花啊，没说叫你用不了还给我们。
他是一个可靠的、很忠厚、很老实的一个这么一个人，
人品非常好。作家里面有文学才能和创作翻译成果多，这是一回事。品德好，精神方面堪为表率，这又是一回事。叶君健是我们的榜样。
CHUN CHANYE always maintained a deep affection for his hometown, to which he donated over 10,000 books, many paintings and works of calligraphy.
他的老家他感情很深，那是山区，很穷，没有水，他就出5000块钱建了个水塔，穷他就出钱买种子建了个果园，希望他们能够搞点副业。中国南方发大水，他当时已经得了癌症，瘫痪在床，那么把他仅剩的20000多块钱稿费，当时是作家里捐的最多的。
CHUN CHANYE was a prolific writer. In March 2010, Tsinghua University published the complete works of CHUN CHANYE.
一年你总有个几十天的长假，还有晚上要抓紧时间，它叫见缝插针，抓紧时间来写作。他最小时候养成的最大的爱好是钓鱼。解放以后呢，我们又后来又离了什刹海近，他就想，哎，有时候我换换脑筋，我是不是去钓鱼去。他就买了一套渔具鱼竿，结果放那几十年他也一次没钓成，就是要抓紧时间写文章。
来了朋友以后啊，他就走了，他不管了。所以客人都是我的客人。他有时候一看那客人还没走，他就看表了，啊，几点了？所以他有个外号叫做看表先生。他甚至有时候我跟他去看一个朋友，我已经进到门去了，他还在走。走了半天，他都回头看看我没有了。哎，他说这人哪去了？我在门洞呢，偷偷的望他。我说你还走吗？他说，你怎么不叫我一声啊？我说你自己走过了，你就不认识，你叫我叫你。他说我没有想，我在想我做文章的事儿呢。所以我有一个朋友也是他的同学，那个同学呀，说原因你真是嫁一个书呆子。
CHUN CHANYE's writing style is plain. The literary techniques in his novels are simple. There's no exaggeration, only straightforward description. There's no attempt to draw in readers with rhetoric and bizarre plots. As he himself said, I tell the story honestly and leave it for the reader to comment. It's a matter of respecting the reader.
There's a Nobel Prize winner, a winner.他就说过，他就说我读过几本关于中国的文学作品，没有一本能像叶君健那样真实的、深刻的、艺术的再现了中国农民的斗争生活。
CHUN CHANYE maintained correspondence with such illustrious writers as Icelandic Nobel Prize laureate Halldór Laxness, chairman of the Norwegian Writers Association and playwright Hans Heiborg, and the famous Danish writer Tyre Merkel. Arthur Miller, author of Death of a Salesman, met CHUN CHANYE in the 1980s. He praised Mountain Village for its focus on characters who were allowed to speak for themselves.He said this was the way to really convince the reader, and that it had been a long time since he'd read such a touching and educational novel.
他既是一个政治家，又要是一个诗人，又要是一个艺术家，这几样东西相结合啊，才能够使他的作品啊，除了反映现实以外，还有具有一定的欣赏价值，能够给读者不仅能够潜移默化，提高他的情操，提高他的意境，还使他能够从中得到快感。
他创作也好，翻译也好，涉及到的文学品种或者题材，这是广泛性，也是很难和他相比的。
他一生发表的已经发表的东西一共是1100万字，那么其中1/3是用的外文，1/3贡献给了儿童文学，儿童文学涵盖创作、翻译、改写、理论四大方面，1/3贡献给了成人文学，成人文学涉及很多方面。
他还有一个别人不能比的语言的功底，很多诺贝尔文学奖获得者都给他写文章介绍他呀。他所取得的文化方面的文化交流方面的成就，包括他翻译像安徒生童话、像其他一些作品获得的荣誉，在中国很难找到和他相比的人。
Despite all the plaudits for his talent, perhaps the greatest miracle of Chun Chanye's life and career was that regardless of the sometimes dramatic changes around him, he never laid down his pen.
His 解放以前和解放以后的本职工作都不是搞创作，他所有这些个自己最大的爱好写作完全是用业余时间做出来的。
Internationally, Chun Chanye was the only Chinese full member of the British and American PENs. In world literary circles, he was recognized as a truly international writer. As such, Chun Chanye belonged not only to China, but also to the world. Hong'an County in Hubei Province was the backdrop to many of Chun Chanye's stories. It's a place that experienced many years of bloody and cruel struggle. It also produced two Chinese state presidents, Dong Biwu and Li Xianyan, as well as over 240 generals who emerged from ordinary farming families, including Han Xianqiu, Chen Xilian and Qin Jiwei. There was also one general who never wore a military uniform.A general in the army of culture, Chun Chanye.
Once it was called Chang'an, today we know it as Xi'an. This ancient capital, home to emperors and their courts, has an unrivaled and epic history. Chang'an enjoyed its golden age during the Tang Dynasty, when a magnificent imperial palace was built there. But what physical evidence of that prosperity remains? Stay tuned for Architecture of Prosperous Tang in the series From Chang'an to Xi'an.